1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2. Go, go. Thank you. Camera feed check. 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2. I think most people will stand around here, not right into the mic. But I'm running post, so if I bring the mic up, it'll...
Can you hear it?
Hello, how are you? Can you see me? I can't hear you. We're about to start. Please let's get settled. The minister is almost finishing the briefing, so please let's take our seats. Okay, yeah, much better. All right, I can see the minister coming. Let's give, I think he's coming with mayors, the board and the CEO. So, yes, if we just remain standing whilst
Is going and coming to the front.
Right, thanks very much. We may be seated. Morning, everyone. My name is Philip Joffa.
Director General of the Department of Science.
I'll be facilitating the program this morning. So I'd like to move the program quite quickly because we are a few minutes late. For that reason, Minister, I was told not to tell my stories today. So I'm afraid, Minister, I will really go straight to the program. And I will not do the acknowledgements again because the acting CEO, Andy Somlisa, has said that she will do that. So I just wanted to acknowledge the minister, the chair of the portfolio committee, and the leadership here led by the executive mayor of Overstrand Municipality, Annelien Rabie, who is just joining at the moment. Of course, we have the board of the space agency led by Mr. Patrick, who is also here, so we acknowledge him. But I think all the acknowledgements properly will be done by Ms. Andy Somlisa, the CEO of the acting CEO of the space agency. I know whenever there's a minister, the chair of the portfolio committee and the leadership, people really become very orderly, Minister, which I guess is fine. And I think we should also remember that today we are celebrating a very, very important event and a demonstration of what in South Africa is an excellent science system. So yes, be tight and listen to the minister and the other dignitaries, but also celebrate because it is a celebration. And it's happening at the time, of course, when we miss this, Andy, so because we usually have October as the month where we go out to the public and excite public about space and what space is capable of doing. But the minister will also talk about other activities that, excuse me, we are embarking on in this area of growing our capabilities in space. So without further ado, then please, let's bring the acting CEO, Andy Somlisa, with a good round of applause, as I say, no formal.
Thank you very much, Mpati. Did you get that, DG? Honorable Minister Dr. Blayden Nzimande. Thank you. Chairperson of the Parliamentary Portfolio Committee for Higher Education and Science and Innovation. The Chairperson of the South African National Space Agency Board, Mr. Patrick Ndlovu. Executive Mayor of Overstrand Municipality, Alderman Annelien Rabie. Executive Mayor of the Overbeck Municipality, Alderman Andres Franken. Ambassadors and representatives from the embassies. Representatives of the South African Weather Services, South African Weather Services, and the Air Traffic and Navigation Services. The CEOs of the South African Weather Service and Air Traffic and Navigation Services. Heads of the African space agencies from Kenya, from Angola, from Zambia, and from Zimbabwe. Delegates from the National Astronautic and Space Administration, that is NASA. Delegation from the United Kingdom Space Academy. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it is my honor on behalf of the South African National of the SANSA Board under the leadership of Mr. Patrick Ndlovu, the SANSA management and the SANSA team at large to welcome you this morning to the SANSA Hermanus facility and most importantly to the momentous launch of the 24/7 operational space weather capability. Minister Nzimande, we started this momentous project under your leadership 3 years ago. It is with pride on our side and hopefully pride on your side that we've completed this project on scope, on budget, and on time, still under your leadership. It is further a demonstration of how an investment in fundamental research, some people call it blue skies research, and also developmental research that yields for fit for purposes, operational capabilities that not only contribute to the economic growth, but also to the socio-economic challenges that the country has. We cannot really take the credit as the SANSA team, though the team has done very wonderfully in ensuring that we are here today. The success we really attribute to the commitment that we've received from the Department of Science and Innovation under the leadership of the Director General, Dr. Phil Mtshwarha. Our national partners, such as the South African Weather Services and AT&S, and the aviation sector at large. The international partners that are here today, as well as those who unfortunately could not be here with us today, such as the European Space Agency and the United Kingdom Met Agency. And of course, to the overwhelming support that we have received from the town of Hermanus and the Overstrand municipality. Our success truly lies in these collaborations and your unwavering commitment to walk this three-year journey with us. My task is really to say, Khululani ibhatyi, nithobe imixakatho, kusekhaya nalapha. All this says is, do find it comfort to take off your jackets. And for as women, make sure that we get made to wear. You are home here. Our success is really your success. And enjoy the celebrations that are about to follow. Thank you, DG.
Thanks very much, Andis. The part minister, where she says under the support of the Director General, I didn't ask her to include that. But I do know that as it is the time for performance appraisal, the minister has has sharp ears, and I'm almost certain he heard that very, very well. And of course, the chair of the portfolio committee. I'm sure as you were driving here, for those who were coming for the first time, and even myself, when I came here for the first time, I asked myself, why is this facility here? I mean, even as you drive from Cape Town, and why are we doing this work here in particular? So yesterday, I think we're celebrating what you will see on the new building, but it also, to put this into context, useful to understand why here and why this place. So the person who spent a lot of time here and who can probably give us a sense of answering this question as you are driving here and as you go home to leave your memories, Dr. Leanne McKenna. So I'm going to ask her to come forward, to come in position today's program, but also just to give the history of why I think we're doing this work here in Hermanus. Dr. McKenna? A very passionate person about the work that she's doing here. Thanks very much. We can bring her with a good round of applause.
So, good morning, Minister, DG, PPC Chair, and SANSA Board and Executives, and ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for joining us this morning. My role this morning is to position the program, tell you why you are here and what makes this launch so special. On behalf of the entire extended SANSA team working behind the scenes, I truly hope that you are as excited as we are to be here today. Today we have not reached the end of the book. However, we have reached the end of a very important section of the book that contained a lot of very important chapters. We are also turning the page in heady anticipation of the next section. The DG referred to why are we here, why does this facility exist here. What many of you may not realize is that this facility has existed in Hermanus for more than 80 years. We celebrated 80 years of magnetic observations from this very position where you're sitting today on the 1st of January 1941. And the reason we came to Amman was because we were looking, not me personally, by the way, but we, the collective we were looking for a magnetically clean environment, an environment that was conducive to research and development, and an environment that would also serve to house what would become an excellent national facility that this country can be proud of. And I'm very proud to be the managing director of this facility and to welcome you all here today. We moved from a magnetic keen environment, 80 years of measuring the Earth's magnetic field, the development of research, and looking at the space environment. And we used that legacy to move to something that is now unique and irreplaceable, and something that South Africa and all of us as South Africans can be proud of. And that brings me to the subject of space weather. So space weather refers to the conditions in space, and this is not going to be a physics lecture, DG, I promised you, and it's not going to be. Refers to the conditions in space emanating from the sun, transmitted via the solar wind, and ultimately impacting the magnetosphere, ionosphere, and thermosphere, which can have adverse influences on the performance and reliability of spaceborne and ground-based technological systems. Basically, everything that we have come to depend on in life, mobile technology, communication systems, navigation applications, even the GPS that you use to make your way here this morning, is vulnerable to the impacts from space weather. Space weather has also been declared a global challenge, and our positioning is such that we are ready to take on that challenge. In 2007, we looked at what participation in the international arena of space weather research and development would be like for South Africa. From the small dream, we took the giant step of opening a limited-focus research and development space weather center in 2010. At the time, we also positioned ourselves to be in the global conversation around space weather. This preparation meant that we were in the right place at the right time when space weather started to be integrated into various systems and procedures, including those of aviation operations. By the end of 2018, we had two international designations as leaders in space weather for the African region, one of which was the designation by ICAO, the International Civil Aviation Organization, as a space weather information provider, one of only five globally. In 2019, SANSA developed a business case for the establishment of an operational space weather services capability to forecast space weather on a 24/7 basis to mitigate the impact of space weather on technological systems. The establishment would take 3 years. It would build on existing space weather research and development legacy in SANSA and would include infrastructure development, instrumentation deployment, product and service development, and capability developed through an investment in the required skills. The establishment project commenced in October 2019 and aimed to be completed by the end of September 2022. 3 years later, we can report a project, as our CEO mentioned, that has been delivered as promised on time and in budget, with direct impacts that includes the creation of professional jobs, temporary construction jobs, and significant impact to the local economy. Indirect impacts, including an increased public interest in science and technology, knowledge generation, international prestige and standing. Human capital development projects have included the recruitment and training of the continent's first ever space weather forecasters, which I hope you all have an opportunity to meet today, because they're the most energetic of our team. The recruitment of the first ever Saatchi research chair in space weather, who by the way is also energetic, sorry, Marty, also energetic, who's addressing a scarce skill in solar physics for the country, and the development of projects for students and interns. We have achieved a number of firsts in the country through this project. Today we come together to launch the Space Weather Capability, a capability that brings to reality our dream of an operational center built on a strong research and development legacy, meets the requirements for international compliance, provides a domestic capability to enable risk mitigation and empower decision making, and contributes towards the development of a national capability in critical skills that improves domestic and regional know-how while enabling mitigation against a natural risk and positions South Africa in the global space market. We want to thank the DSI, who believed in our dream and partnered with us to make this happen. And the DG mentioned my passion for this project, but he didn't mention, what he was trying to imply was that I drove him mad over the years about this project. Today we stand tall and proud with you, our principals, our stakeholders, friends and supporters. Thank you for supporting this journey to deliver a proudly South African project and for joining SANSA in beautiful Hermanus outside our beautifully constructed Space Weather Center to celebrate with us and the DSI as we mark the significant milestone and the beginning of a new chapter for space science on this continent. Thank you.
Yes, thanks very much, Leanne. I'm told, and our apologies, that we are also joined by SANSA team, as well as the DSI team online. This is being streamed through YouTube, I think, so our apologies for that. Minister, I'm always asked if I should introduce you before you come and speak. And the minister knows one time I came to a meeting and I was wearing a tie. I said, "Minister, I had to wear a tie today because I am presenting." I think it was the first time I'm presenting to the minister, to the general secretary of the SACP at that time. And then he reminded me that actually the communists don't wear a tie. So I think, Minister, I'm not going to take the risk again of introducing you, except to say that I think from the department side, we really are honored to have somebody who demonstrate leadership and provide all the necessary support for the work that as a department we do, but also as a sector, because our job in government is also to provide leadership and support to the entire national system of innovation. So it is my great pleasure and honor then to invite our minister, Dr. Bladen Zimande, one of the few ministers who has two DGs, higher education and science and innovation, to please come forward and say a few words about why we're here today. Honorable Minister, round of applause.
Thank you very much. DG. Let me say thank you very much. I'll come here as many times as you want me to, because you have got your podium right in terms of the height. So anytime you invite me, I will come here. It's one of those few places on Earth, though you are space science, that is able to be non-discriminatory when it comes to podiums. Let me start by greeting our program director, our DG, Dr. Philip Joaha, the chairperson of the Portfolio Committee on Higher Education, Science. Are you innovation now? Because the last I remember, you were technology. Okay. Ms. Nompendulo Mkhatswa, the Overstrand Local Municipality Mayor, Dr. Anel Rabi, and the executive mayor of the Overberg District Municipality, Mr. Andres Franken, and the deputy mayor of the local municipality, Lindi Lensabo. Let me also greet the chairperson of the SANSA board, Mr. Patrick Ndlovu Gajen, and the SANSA CEO, Ms. Andy Soa Mlisa, the SANSA Managing Director for Space Science, Dr. Leanne McKenna, who has just given us the background now. Officials from the Ministry and the Department of Science and Innovation. Let me also acknowledge the ambassadors and representatives of embassies, my special advisors who are here, representatives of boards of the South African Weather Services, and of course the board members of SANSA, the Air Traffic and Navigation Services. I thought I was lost when I saw this, because I thought I was Minister of Transport before 2019. I remember this was one of my entities, ATNS. I thought I was lost, or maybe I've been unofficially redeployed back to transport. But I'm very pleased that you are here, representatives from AMSCO. Also, let's extend a special, special welcome to heads of African space agencies. Very special welcome to you from Kenya, Angola, Zimbabwe, and Zambia, as well as NASA delegates, and also representatives from the UK Space Academy. Members of the media, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. I'm really very delighted to be joining you today as we launch South Africa's new 24-hour state-of-the-art regional space weather center here at Hermanus. It's good to be back, Leanne, I must say. You know, when I was here, I was turning a sword. I was here to turn the sword. There is nothing as nice as, after turning a sword, you come back. Now, only after 3 years, there is a facility, and we are launching. Sometimes you turn a sword, you come back after 2 years, all you find is a grass as tall as this. So it's very important, you know, that there is no grass except where we have deliberately planted it, you know, but a facility like this, it really is very, very nice. This is a historic day, and it's truly a historic development, this. And I wish our friends in the media really help us to tell the story. It's a good South African story. It actually is a further illustration of the excellence we have in science in South Africa. It is yet another demonstration that the Department of Science and Innovation, together with its agencies, continue to respond to the socio-economic challenges of our country by using science, technology, and innovation as a catalyst and a catalyzer for economic development. As part of our firm and determined support to government's economic reconstruction and recovery program, the ERRP as we call it, we built a long-term national capacity to deal with COVID-19 and future pandemic threats. We secured higher levels of public and private investment in South African research and development, and we have continued to support the revitalization of existing sectors and industries. At the same time, we continue with research and development to modernize existing economic sectors in our country, such as mining, through support for research and development, both to ensure a safer working environment for miners and to increase the lifespan of mining in the country. Mining still remains the backbone of our economy. Of course, it provides us with lots of opportunities in terms of beneficiation and platforms for developing new technologies. Indeed, DG, you did not know this. You have your science week every year. But we had an unofficial science week this week, by the way. Yesterday, I opened the CSIR biennial conference on science under the theme Harnessing Research, Development, and Innovation for a Robust South African Economy. Today, we are launching this International Space Weather Center, the only one in the African continent and one of the five in the world. Tomorrow, we are holding the second ever meeting of the Interministerial Committee on Science, Technology, and Innovation, established by the president and asked me to chair it. We are holding the second, 1 week, CSIR Biennial, International Space Weather Center, and the Interministerial Committee. All this is very important parts, components of taking forward our 10-year plan, our decadal plan on science, technology, and innovation, and our determination to use and support science as an integral part of our developmental agenda. I can't help but only boast, by the way, that when the Director General of the World Health Organization visited South Africa, he said to us, South Africa is the only country in the world that managed to deploy science in the day-to-day management of COVID-19, like no other country. So this is continuing with our prowess that indeed we are a very scientific nation. Now, back to our launch today, the South African National Space Agency, SANSA, is an entity of government, and as such, it has a responsibility to the citizens of South Africa in contributing towards addressing poverty, unemployment and inequality, and promoting the development and security of all South Africans. Launched on the 9th December 2009, SANSA's key strategic outcomes are aligned to the following Department of Science and Innovation strategic outcomes as provided for in our 2020 to 2025 strategic plan. Firstly, we want a transformed, inclusive, responsive, and coherent national system of innovation. Increased knowledge generation and innovation output as a second outcome. Thirdly, human capabilities and skills for the economy and for development. Fourthly, knowledge utilization for economic development, focusing on revitalizing existing industry and stimulating research and development-led industrial development. Fifthly, knowledge utilization for inclusive development. And sixthly, innovation and support of a capable and developmental state. SANSA's mandate is to provide for the promotion and use of space and cooperation in space-related activities, foster research in space science, advance scientific engineering, develop human capabilities in space science, and support the creation of an environment conducive to industrial development in space technologies within the framework of our national government policy. It is therefore expected that SANSA should focus and optimize its resources to maximize the benefits of space services and applications in society. As an innovation-oriented country, South Africa is hugely reliant on space-based applications and services. And therefore, the establishment of SANSA is strategically important for addressing our local challenges and improving the lives of our citizens, whilst at the same time positioning ourselves to contribute towards transnational and planetary scale cooperation and collaborations to ensure the sustainability and prosperity of global humanity. It is in this context where our strategic collaboration with bilateral and multilateral agencies is absolutely crucial. Agencies to partner with us. A decade ago, as South Africa, we had a number of organizations working in isolation in various space-related products and services. For example, the Satellite Application Center, which was aligned to the Council for Scientific and Industrial Research, and the Hermanus Magnetic Observatory, which was in the fold of the National Research Foundation. We therefore had to rationalize and realign these two within SANSA's four strategic programs: space science, space operations, space engineering, and Earth observation. Through SANSA, we now have managed to improve coordination of South Africa's space arena to maximize the benefits of current and planned space activities, avoid or minimize duplication of resources and efforts, and organize existing initiatives, programs, and institutions into a coherent network for all providers and users of space systems. We also managed to promote capacity building initiatives, both as a means towards effective participation in the space arena, as well as to develop capacity in space science and technology, and science and technology in general. At some stage in Facebook, I was being projected as flying on a broom and being credited for having introduced a bachelor's degree in witchcraft. I must say, all of those were mistaken. You know, I am real space, not through a broom, through Sansa, in a scientific way. More importantly, we have also facilitated the provision of appropriate and adequate space capabilities to support South Africa's domestic and foreign policy objectives. For instance, during the recent floods in KwaZulu-Natal, we provided satellite imagery to the National Disaster Management Center and COCTA to support our disaster response efforts and understanding the level of damage. We also provided, by the way, the same services at the Jacobsfontein mine waste dam that collapsed. The space weather capability that we are launching today is a direct response to our good safety track record that led to the International Civil Aviation Organization. I'm back to transport. Selecting Sansa as one of the two regional centers to provide space weather services, including solar storm forecasts and warnings to the global aviation sector. Now, Program Director and ladies and gentlemen, as you may know, in the South African context in 2019, Cabinet approved the new white paper on science, technology, and innovation that sets long-term direction and trajectory for science, technology, and innovation in our country. This white paper is now our principal policy guiding the national system of innovation and commits South Africa to further the role of STI, as we call science, technology, and innovation, in economic and social development, emphasizing the core themes of inclusivity, transformation, and partnerships. And this is important. We have to transform the science, technology, and innovation landscape for more participation by Black South Africans and for more participation by women. This is not a political intervention. It's a necessary societal intervention. Those who dismiss this as political, they are themselves political. We are being scientific. We can't build a South Africa if we leave behind 51% of its population, which is women. If we leave out more than 80% Black South Africans behind, how can we say we are building a country? We are implementing our white paper on science, technology, and innovation through our decadal plan, 2021-2031, which is aligned to our national development plan. Our launch here today is part of our overall strategy to position science, technology, and innovation at the center of our developmental agenda. Now, this project, Leanne has said something about it. I do need to say, though, Sansa developed a business case for the establishment of the space weather services capability in 2019. I have to tell this story as well. It's a nice one. The establishment took 3 years and building on the existing space weather research and development legacy, as Leanne has explained, in Sansa. It included infrastructure development, instrumentation development, product and service development, and skills capability development. The process of establishment of the new Space Weather Center was completed by the end of September 2022. Our total investment in this capability amounted to 107.5 million rands over the 3 years, which included a ring-fenced establishment grant of 70.89 million. Rand received from my Department of Science and Innovation, and 36.6 million invested directly by Sansa from this Hermanus facility. You know, when we presented recently, the DG remembers this, in cabinet, on how we are doing in terms of science, technology and innovation, investment into research and development. The president said, by the way, you are not fully utilizing your science infrastructure and facility in Zimande to showcase what South Africa is capable for. He then said, we must promote tourism, science tourism. Very important. And mentioned the SKA to Carnarvon. President is absolutely right. But we must also then also promote this center as part of our science tourism. We are chairing BRICS, the four countries, four or five. Brazil, Russia, India, China, South Africa, five. Okay. We are chairing BRICS this year. And one of the things I'm going to do will be to invite the ministers of science and innovation from BRICS. And when they come here, DG, it's important we take them to SKA and we also bring them here. To showcase who we are. That we are not in Qatar for the World Cup does not mean you must take South Africa lightly. We have to prove, you know, that in a space science World Cup, we would be there in Qatar. You know, unfortunately, it's not. Ladies and gentlemen, significant strides have since been made by SANSA since its formative years. We have to say this. For its 11th year, SANSA has continued to implement its strategic programs, which led to its researchers making significant contributions to global scientific knowledge in space and earth sciences, while government departments and customers benefited from the provision of high-quality satellite data products and services. Some of the key successes of SANSA include the following. If we don't say these things, we are underselling ourselves. Firstly, the establishment of a space infrastructure hub, which marked a key milestone in the entity's infrastructure development objectives, skills, capacity development, and job creation within the space industry. The establishment of the first SANSA research chair, funded by our National Research Foundation. Another achievement is the launch of this very new 24/7 Regional Space Weather Center. SANSA's provision of synthetic aperture radar data to the National Oceans and Coastal Information Management System, which aims to develop world-class decision-making tools to improve the integrity of maritime data that is crucial to our international trade and seafaring interests. We are a maritime country, by the way, but we are still far from fully realizing and utilizing that capacity. My special advisor, Dr. Swartz, knows exactly what I'm talking about because his former university, where he was a vice chancellor, is one of our leading institutions in maritimes and ocean science. SANSA is also mapped South Africa's informal settlements. That's interesting. We know our informal settlements better where and how they are located, not when we are on the ground, from space. Very important. SANSA is also working with the National Space Research and Development Agency and has developed space weather products for forecasting over the African region. Now, in keeping with its objectives of supporting the development of a critical mass of skills and expertise needed to give effect to National Space Initiative, SANSA supported 46 postgraduate students in key space science disciplines in 2020-2021 financial year. A total of 2,937 learners also benefited from SANSA outreach and space awareness initiatives. Through SANSA researchers, South Africa has a growing international footprint and impact on new research within the space sector. In March 2021, three SANSA researchers published an article in Polar Science on a unique observation of a medium-scale traveling ionospheric disturbance using SANSA's SuperDAN radar, making the first ever estimate of power dissipated by this phenomenon. If you ask me what this is, yona leo, it's that one. Yio leo yona loizo. True to its vision to provide routine and reliable Earth observation data to tackle some of Africa's greatest socioeconomic and sustainability challenges, SANSA's Earth Observation Program remains at the heart of delivering data products and services to important sectors of government and industry, such as the deployment of Earth observation tools in the recent fires of the Western Cape. Another example is the use of these tools for monitoring the impact of climate change on crops. Now, this is very important, by the way, because many people say, Zimande, why do you tell us that you have invested 70 million rands into space science? We don't live in space. We live in Hermanos, we live in Khayelitsha, we live in Soweto. Why waste? We need housing there. Now, this is an explanation that space science makes us to understand the ground we are on much better and improved safety and security and protect our planet and spaces better. It does not mean that what happens in space is not important, because what happens in space or doesn't happen, which is supposed to happen, can have huge consequences for our Earth. I was telling the DG, we've got our own project with Dr. Swartz, who will ask my other special advisor to join, to really study if there are other, there is human life somewhere else in the universe. By the way, there's a book I was supposed to buy at Exclusive Books. I like going into Exclusive Books when I have time. But I got disturbed by another book, and I forgot about it, which in its blurb at the back, it was saying, existing science only understands only 5% of the universe. Only 5%. So you can see the space and the scope for an entity like SANSA. If we only understand 5% of the universe, we don't know what else is there. That's why with my special advisor, we really believe there is life somewhere else. Not out of a religious belief per se, but out of science and its applications. So SANSA, that's your other task, Leanne. Help us with Dr. Swartz to determine if indeed there is life somewhere else. We were just making our own hypothesis that the people who live somewhere else are much kinder than us. They look at us as fools because we still shoot at each other and do all these funny things. That's why when they visit, you know, they don't stay for long. They just come and go back and say, this is no place to stay, you know? Now, this is scientific questions that we are posing, okay? It's not manga beliefs or something like that. Through our support then as a department, SANSA has ensured that its increased focus on transforming the space sector through skills development and public outreach is important. You know, I want to challenge all my entities, by the way, not least SANSA, that in all the work that you do, can you please incorporate science literacy in your work using the area in which you are operating? Just to educate ordinary people about the importance of science and what science does. DG, this is going to be in our 2023-2024 APP, establishment of a viable science literacy program in our country. And all our entities must have this as a component. We still have lots of beliefs that we know are against science and doubt science. COVID-19 exposed us to that, by the way. So science literacy is very important. Now, SANSA also has a role to play in international space cooperation. For example, we are currently negotiating with the U.S. Space Agency, NASA, for the establishment of a tracking and telemetry station in Machiefontein in support of future lunar exploration on the moon. That's us, South Africa. That's our Qatar World Cup space, you know, not the football one. The space agency also continues to implement activities targeting women in science and the previously disadvantaged youth, whilst also using space science to inspire future generations of space scientists and entrepreneurs across the country through its public engagement program. Thousands of learners have through the years engaged with SANSA, experts at science and career festivals, school visits, science centers, and now even online. Our science center here in Hermanus also hosts educator workshops to support educators in the teaching of physics at schools. Now, our DG is happy. If I have spoken without mentioning physics once, I was going to have challenges back in the office. DG, just to repeat for you, workshops support educators in the teaching of physics. Space science is a global industry, and SANSA has extensive partnerships with space agencies and organizations across the world, through which it has provided numerous opportunities for the local space industry and academia. The agency partners with African countries, which is absolutely important, to provide training in the application of space technologies and to create a network of scientific nodes for aligned research on the continent. By the way, those who do not know, the African Union has established what is called the Pan-African Virtual University. Each region of the continent has got its own specialization. Southern Africa has been asked to focus on space science, and South Africa is the coordinating country. That's us. That's who we are as South Africans. The African Resource Management Constellation is one such initiative which looks at African partners contributing a constellation of Earth observation satellites to allow Africa to manage more efficiently its natural resources and ensure food security, not only, by the way, just food security, nutrition security as well, because that's important. It's not enough to eat, you must eat nutritious food, whilst also reducing costs and reliance on international satellite providers. This demonstrates the rationale for cross-border cooperation across the African continent and pulling together science, technology, and innovation resources to confront common existential problems. By the way, one big battle, and I want all of our entities to also do something on this. How do we advance an African research agenda in the area in which we are operating in a manner that Africa is able to determine independently its own research and development needs? Because even where we share the same global challenges like climate change, but their impact on the African continent are unique. So all our my entities, please, an African agenda and how to resource that African agenda. It's very, very important. By the way, us as South Africans, again, Sis Nompendulo Mukhatshwa, our chairperson, we are holding for the first time the World Science Forum, which will be the first time it is being held on the African continent. All the global scientists will be here from the 6th to the 9th of December 2022 in Cape Town because of who we are. That is why I always tell people, don't say how do we adapt to the fourth industrial revolution. For ours is not just to adapt, it's also to contribute innovation and creativity into the fourth industrial revolution. Now, I need to indicate that I remain heartened to witness the contribution by Sansa to our people and the global space industry through knowledge generation and excellence in service support to our space partners around the world, as well as Sansa's contribution to local industry and our economy, despite the constraints that we have. Examples, for instance, of this important economic role of Sansa include its work in the agricultural economy through the use of open and big data for vegetation condition and stress monitoring, crop and other vegetation assessment, estimation of cropped arable land and production area statistics, the above ground biomass and yield estimation and agricultural drought assessment and monitoring. Sansa also contributes significantly to the national economy and job creation through various projects such as satellite development and testing for various space missions, big data platforms like data visualization centers, the activation of a satellite-based augmentation system over Southern Africa, and the development of the required human talent. Despite the ravages of the global pandemic, COVID, Sansa continued to work diligently in delivering its set of projects, regardless of the limitations brought by the COVID-19 pandemic. This includes managing its corporate governance well by being granted a clean audit. By the way, you built this in the midst of COVID, which is a huge, huge achievement, I must say that. And this is the reason why we must congratulate the board, the management, and all Sansa employees. You remain as one of our entities that continue to make us proud as the higher education, science, and innovation sector. Except we have a deal, Chair. This is good. You can't have Sansa branding without science and innovation branding. Everywhere and all the time. Otherwise, you won't get funding for another project. Like this. You know? My dear mayors, aren't you lucky as the mayors of this place to have a facility like this here? Your place, your area will never be the same again. In conclusion, I'm looking forward to even greater accomplishments from this young agency of our department with its growth trajectory fueled by ambitious aspirations. Continue being ambitious. There's nothing wrong in being ambitious. Big things come from being ambitious. And as South Africans, we are capable of being ambitious and reaping benefits from our ambitiousness. Ishmael, you wrote here that today, that's my speechwriter now, he wants me to say, today is not a day of long speeches, but I have already given a relatively long speech. My God, what were you expecting? You write a long speech, then you want me to conclude, today is not a day for long speeches. It was a relatively long speech because it's a day to be proud of today. And I had to say that. So let me therefore take this opportunity to thank the board chairperson, the executive management, our mayors, our portfolio committee chair, our partners, entire staff of Sansa for your sterling work. It's a great day for our country today and for this small but very important municipality here where we are. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much, Minister. Lately, Minister, I've been telling people that I'm about to retire. And every time I tell them that, they ask me to go back to Home Affairs and check whether the person who filled my birth date on my birth certificate did it correctly. Because they say I look very young for somebody who's about to retire. After having listened to the minister, do you blame me why I look young if I work with a minister like this? Really so good at delivering not so long speeches. All right, thanks very much, Minister. Really inspiring, and thanks very much. So now, I'd like to do two things. I would have said something, Minister, about DG being excited about physics, but because we're running late of time, you have to be on SABC in a few minutes. I was going to say a few words about that. But also, I was going to say something about the proposal for the BRICS ministers here in Cape Town. I had the opportunity, Minister, to fly further down 3 hours from Cape Town, where the Superdan facility, the radar that you're talking about on your speech is. And I would proudly suggest that you also consider a visit to Antarctica. It's an excellent visit, Minister. I promise you, I had never slept in a tent, but when I was there, I slept in a tent. So I'm sure, again, Dr. Swart would be delighted and be proud of the DG who slept in a tent in Antarctica. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we're now almost at the end of the first part. So the first part will be coming to an end, the executive mayor that you've had of the Overstrand municipality, Annelien Rabi, will give a vote of thanks, and then I'll give you a sense of where to from here. A round of applause for Annelien.
This is indeed a bit low, Minister. But luckily, I've got a loud voice. Ask my husband. Minister and Ismail, I must actually address Ismail. No long speeches, but for heaven's sakes, never give a politician a microphone. We seem to not be able to shut up. Minister, before I do my vote of thanks, I want to appreciate you in person. I really love and enjoy your commitment to research. I myself am a research junkie. And I believe without research, we won't be where we want to be. If there's no research, we won't go places. And we wish to congratulate you and thank you for choosing Amanus. Now, I am the mayor of Overstrand, and those of you who live in the other areas of Overstrand, forgive me if I reference Amanus only today. But in 1969, this facility, we called it the Seismological Center at that time, was the place we called about the earthquake in Ceres, where I lived at the time. And what we said is, wanneer gaan daar nog 'n tremor kom? And everybody would say, call Hermanus. And that's how this place became stuck in my memory as the place that protected us on further earth tremors at that time. Then I also would like to acknowledge Dr. McKinnell. And Minister, you made right choices. Everyone that was of name and fame here today were women. A project on budget and in time. If I look at the young doctorates, ladies with doctorates who's working in the center, it is a blessing to my heart because they also come from this town. Some of them grew up in one of the most poverty-stricken areas in our area called Zwelihle, just across the bridge here. And many people, when you pass them in the street, you will never imagine they hold a doctorate in one of the most exciting sciences of our time. And congratulations and thank you for that. Obviously, the development, as you've heard, of this space weather capability has been a 3-year project throughout COVID. There are a number of organizations, as usually, that have been instrumental players in making this dream a reality. And on behalf of SANSA and the Overstrand Municipality, of which I'm a very proud mayor, I would like to thank you very much with appreciation for everything that you've done. Though these include the Department of Science and Innovation, the Line Department for SANSA, and the primary funder for this capability. Our key stakeholders, partners, were at Air Traffic Navigation Services and the South African Weather Services, who have been in conversation with SANSA since 2013, supporting and driving wherever possible to ensure that the country and the region are equipped for this capability. The Department of Transport, sir, who represent the state at ICAO and put SANSA forward as South Africa's nomination for a designated space weather provider. Obviously, that's why I have to say you have to bring the BRICS ministers here, and I promise you I will bribe for you. You have to come. And we'll give you seafood and perlemoen and crayfish and everything that we could poach. So you're on that one, sir. Then we have the UK Met Office, who provided advice, guidance, and the training platform for Africa's first space weather forecasters. Do you actually understand what it means? It is emotional. It is unbelievable. Here in our own Hermanus. Just incredible. AVN and Osmond Lang Architects, edge-to-edge construction, and thank you very much for using many of the people in Hermanus who would otherwise not have had food on the table during that time. And then, of course, the nearest business partner and an important player, given the role that they fulfill in the community here, is the Hermanus MediClinic, just across the road from here. Thank you very much, also for your support in many ways. And then finally, a thank you to Abergold, to Massmart Holdings, the town of Hermanus, and officials from my own municipality for all the support, for coming together, and to making sure that this is indeed a joyous and momentous day. Thank you very much for being here.
Thanks very much, Mayor. Now, this brings us to the end on the first part of brief and short speeches which you've had. We are intended now to go to the second part, which is the ribbon cutting and photo opportunity at the back and the unveiling of the plug. Minister, I'm told that you have to be in two places at the same time because SAPC would like to talk to you in about 5 minutes. And SANSA and all of us would like you to do the ribbon cutting and the unveiling of the plug. So what we would like to suggest is that we give ourselves 5 minutes for a comfort break and mingling, as well as maybe coffee. Andiso, would that be okay? And then we will then start to move to the building, I think, behind us. And by that time, hopefully, the minister will be done with the engagement with SABC live, unfortunately, Minister, that's why. And then we'll invite then the minister to do the ribbon cutting and the photo opportunity, unveiling of the plug, and then there would be a demonstration inside. Now, because the environment and the space is small, we would like you to allow the minister and the dignitaries to be in the demonstration first, and then after that, the others would be invited. We'll have a media briefing at 12:30 to 1. And then after that, I'm told there would be canapes and refreshments back here in the tent. So let's give ourselves 5 or 7 minutes. If you haven't spoken to the person next to you, this is the time to say hi, who your name is and which district you come from, and how much you are earning and how much you're happy to donate part of your money to the person. And then we will then start moving back in about 5 or 7 minutes. Thank you very much.
That sounds like, whoa.
1, 2, 1, 2.
Yeah.
not sure. I'm not
Hi,
sure.
I'm Gideon. Hi. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
You must be in the picture.
Yes, it can't be this way. It has to be this way.
Yeah, it has to be that way.
Yes. Yes.
Make it easier.
I'm not sure who's going to speak. Do we know who's going to speak?
Other side of the blue.
Is there someone speaking?
There's a protocol. There's a hierarchy.
Yeah, but you're part of the hierarchy.
I'm not sure what to do with this.
I'm actually
going to three. You need to wait
for the end. We are going to count to three.
No, 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 wait.
You need to wait for the end.
Sorry, everybody. Can we just hold on a second, please? Can you just step back on the outside there so we can get the building in, guys? There, can you please come forward in the background? Can you please come out the shot? Thank you. Hold on a second, and all of you guys, too, please come this side of the ribbon.
Can we just grab that tripod?
And that tripod. Can you
join us? Are you fine now?
Not nearly. Please, can you come out? So, guys, come out.
Show them the inside, and then when you step out, we'll give you an opportunity. Thank you. Well, there is somebody there.
We can wait outside.
Yeah,
we can wait outside.
Thank you.
The Space Weather Center was officially launched by Minister of Higher Education, Science and Innovation, Dr. Blade Nzimande, on 3rd November 2022. Okay.
Just that there's the noise for the stream.
Okay.
There's a mic outside here, those who speak.
Sorry.
Oh, no, I'm ask questions to the
Where are the others?
Okay. So Mayor, welcome. These are our. Hello. Okay. Hello.
Oh, I'm just holding it. So I was giving it. No, but this one is for live stream. It's not for the
sound system.
Inside. Okay, that's why you were giving it to me. Okay, I didn't understand that. Sorry.
Maybe just hold it. Okay, Minister, welcome to our Space Weather Center. This is the control room, the heart of where everything happens. And the team in front of you, on either side of the screen, is, okay? Are we still okay? All right. The team on the other side of the screens are our space weather forecasting team. Over here you have Dr. Mimpo Shishofungu. She is the head of space weather. This is her domain. She controls what happens here. And her team of forecasters are on the other side. Please note, Minister, that they are almost all young ladies.
Yes.
So we have, yes. So we have a very young, very energetic forecasting team that have been on training, and we arranged, although we run the center 24/7, we arranged for us to be only on day shift today and this week so that they could meet you themselves, all of them. They couldn't choose which one was going to be here, so they all came. And I'm going to hand over to her. She's going to tell you just a little bit about what you're seeing here in front of you.
Make it simpler.
Thank you. I will make it simple. Welcome to our Space Weather Center.
Can you hear the sound? Can you hear inside in?
Yes.
No, they can't hear you outside.
You can't hear me outside? You can't hear, that's not very clear from the inside, ladies.
Okay, can you hear me now?
Okay, thank you,
Paul. Okay. Thank you and welcome to our Space Weather Center.
Regional Warning Center for Africa. Before I start with what is here, I would like to introduce my team. We have a special team here, starting from Salma Khan. Can you just wait when I so that they can know who you are? And then we have Ntanze Gombele. And then we have Mantriye Malachi. Then we have Nondumiso Kumalo. And then we have Witumelo Makombe. And then we have Katekile Shivambu. And then we have Ngosinathi Masangu. And the only gentleman in the house is the Mupo Mele. Yeah, so the only gentleman among all these beautiful ladies. So this is the team that you see who are working behind the scenes to make this 24/7 operation running or keeping it running. So thank you to the team. So what you see here today is what we are always monitoring as the team, the space weather conditions in near real time. And it has been mentioned during the speeches, space weather is a global phenomenon, but it has a regional impact. So it's very important that we build up on our regional capabilities and be able to monitor the impact that space weather has on a regional basis. So what is important is that space weather is a global phenomenon, so the international collaboration is also crucial for us. So we collaborate with many of our international partners, and then also we build up from the expertise or skills that we have to be able to develop our own regional expertise. So what you're looking at here, I'm going to simplify it, is just the sun is our main driver for space weather. So we are looking at anything which is happening on the sun. This is space weather storms. So anything that is happening on the sun, we know it will affect our space-based and ground-based technological systems. And to actually measure the magnitude of the impact on a regional basis, we have the ground-based instrumentation to look at the impact. That's why here it has been a magnetic observatory for more than 8 years, and we have been measuring this disturbance on what is happening on the sun, on the ground, and how it will affect us on a regional basis. So what you see is the data is latest information that we get from different satellites. Satellite is the data that we collaborate with other space weather centers like the US Space Weather Center, the UK, and the ESA. So with this collaboration, we are able to share the data, and we also compensate it with our regional space weather information so that we can see the impact. So what we have done is that in addition to some of the global models that you see here to show us the atmospheric conditions which affect our satellite signals, which are coming from satellite into the ground, we also build our regional capabilities. So we have a regional model called the AfriTech. It actually gives us the indication on a regional basis to say, if there's something happening on the sun, how will it affect me here in Africa? Mm-hmm. So that's why we have this regional information. Because on a global scale, it takes just a few stations around the globe and it can give you a global aspect. But on a regional basis, you also need to have this enough instrumentation within the African region so that you see what's happening on a regional basis. So for us, being a space weather center or designated by the Civil Aviation Organization, we had to move from our limited focus, space weather impact on HF communication, and also look into operating on a 24/7 basis. So we look at space weather impact on high frequency communication, the global navigation satellite system applications, and then radiation exposure at aviation altitude. So this is the information that we are required to provide to the aviation industry so that they know what is happening with space, and then they can effectively communicate during a space weather event. So this is why it is important for us to monitor space weather conditions and send the warnings and advisories to our customers so that they know what's happening and how they are affected or their technologies are affected. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Are we allowed to ask one or two questions? Yeah, no, just two questions on my part. One, are there any similarities between the weather we know and space weather in terms of different conditions, you know, and all that? Is there something new? What are the different things, you know, and so on? Just out of curiosity, frankly. Secondly, to what extent is this also a source of research, data research and so on? Can I come as a researcher here to study certain patterns, whatever the case may be?
Minister?
Oh, should I repeat?
Yes, so that we can hear on the outside.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
No, firstly I was saying, how similar or different is space weather in terms of different conditions, rainy, cloudy, cold, hot, and so on, vis-a-vis our, I don't know what you call it, our weather, terrestrial weather. Okay, that's now Sansa language. Number two, is this a possible space for research? Like this very space center that you could get researchers coming here, or there is information stored somewhere else if you want to come and do research about aspects of space weather.
Okay, thank you. So I will answer the first one. With the difference between space weather and terrestrial weather, there is a difference because with space weather, our main activity is happening on the sun. So we also use different satellites to look at what's happening beyond our atmosphere. With the terrestrial weather, it's within our atmosphere. So for us, we are looking at the altitude of about 80 kilometers above the ground, which is the layer. This is beyond the atmosphere, and it's ionized by the energetic particles from the sun. And the main impact of what we look at is our technological system, because we are so dependent on the satellite, which are orbiting up in space. You're using it for your GPS, for your navigation, satellite communication, DSTV, internet, everything is dependent on satellite. But to get the signal from satellite to the ground, it has to pass through the space, which is sometimes there's a storm happening. So we need to know if there's a storm happening, it can interfere with the signals which are coming from it. So it's different from the terrestrial weather. But we have our meteorological forecasters here. We did have a training on space weather. So the skills can be transferable from one to the other part. So with regard to the training, like we just did with the with training the new space for the broadcasters, all of them except the gentlemen. we have a program. We have researchers here. Some of them, they are affiliated with universities. And then we do send out the invitation for bursaries. So we support the students from honors, masters, and PhDs. And they come and look at the data. We have a lot of data to look at. And then we have a research and development, it's a big part of space of what we do here. And also we are partnering with some of our African institutions to deploy more instruments within the African region. As you can see, maybe just a few on this one, you can see we need more coverage to have a spatial resolution of the data or what's happening. So we are installing different instrumentation within the African region so that we can expand our capability. So with our African partnership, we are working strongly for research and development.
So Minister, this whole capability has been built on a research and development legacy. And it's also created a new chapter in research and development here in Sansa. So space weather operations is one aspect, but here we are able to demonstrate the entire value chain from the research to operations. And we have dedicated researchers in every domain we're looking at. So we have researchers dedicated to navigation, to communications, and to radiation exposure. And this has created a lot of new projects and new excitement with students because they want to come and be part of the centre as well now. So we have a lot of student development infrastructure on the site as well, and the higher education training part of what we do is very important.
So what do they study to forecast?
You have to repeat your question, right. Sorry.
Thank you so much, and I think from where we come from, when we see a room like this, we'd say Malibongwe, it's really exciting to see this minister. But my question is, so that we can see more of yourselves, when those of us go and interact with young people as ambassadors of the higher education and training department or sector to guide young people on their careers and what they should study, I want to tell them how exciting whatever is happening is. I need to also tell them what to study in order for them to be part of such a really massive project that we are proud to say is birthed here in South Africa, in Harmonis.
So we need a wide variety of skills in space. So here in the Space Weather Centre, it's predominantly physics. Unfortunately, sorry young people, maths as well. But also, we are also needing computer science skills, coding, programming. That is absolutely crucial. We look at remote sensing, data analysis skills. The young ladies that you see in front of you have got a mixture of young ladies and the gentlemen, statistics, physics, meteorology. there's quite a wide range, and that diversification of the skills also gives us a very strong program. So our bursary program has now expanded to include those skills because those are the skills we need as well. Yeah.
Well, in Sizu, okay? Sasa zangu mazizu. Ni zangu mazumkati, am I right? Umkati lives. I'm sorry. Is that right? Okay. That's part of this training for my science literacy project.
Okay.
Oh,
okay.
All right.
All right. Yeah.
Okay. Some more questions?
No, that's fine. I would really love to take a photo with them.
Yes.
I'm
yes.
sure
yes.
they will.
Inside Minister.
Yes, they look awesome.
That's right.
This is our Zantiaya night.
So you can ask just, I'm not going to take another room, but I need room. Thank you.
We can all come in.
Okay.
And all be.
All right. Big smiles from everyone. We all in?
Yeah.
Okay. 1, 2, 3. Wonderful. Everyone go?
What are the signs of signs? The signs of signs. Show us the signs of signs.
Thank you.
One more person.
Okay.
Yes, yes, yes.
We're going to have to move back a bit. Come back a bit.
Yes.
Oopsie-daisy.
ATNS is a very important client.
Of course. Science actions, please. No, the center is a commercial center. It is a commercial center.
Excuse me, ladies and gentlemen. I don't want you to leave here with an impression that I'm a control freak. I know we get excited, but so the next phase is for the minister, chair. We are going to have the media Q&A at the auditorium. And the others can join at the back. So if we allow the minister.
But so you'll be live. Green.
Okay,
and then you're live. Yeah, I'll just
to
push
ask the questions to the minister. Oh, you want the mic as well?
Yeah,
when you ask questions, can
I need the mic on the stand?
The gentleman, can you please give us that mic on the stand? Can it work? All right.
It will work.
All right. No, we do have one here. Thank you. So we'll provide you with the mic to ask a question and the minister will respond. Please just identify yourself and the media organization that you represent. Thank you very much. By the show of hand, I will recognize you and then you can pose your question. Do you have any take up? Okay, the lady will be the first and then another one?
Yeah.
Okay, the second one, we'll start there. Can we take the mic up, please?
We take question.
All right.
And answer. Question and answer. Because I all don't right. have anything to write.
Okay, on.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I just wanted to know, you touched...
Yes, can you identify yourself?
Of course. My name is Rosanna Philander. I'm a freelance journalist for Africa International Magazine. I wanted to know...
Sorry.
Okay, I wanted to know, you mentioned it earlier on actually, that around the world we only know 5% of what's actually happening in the whole universe. How much do you know, how much do you think or know that we in South Africa actually know what's going on? If you can answer that question.
Yeah, no, that's a very detailed and technical question. Maybe I need to ask the experts to actually answer that. You know, as to in South Africa, how much we know. We don't know what we don't know. Yes, that's right. It's a difficult one. Okay, I'll ask someone. Who would like to take that one? Yes, Leanne. Yeah.
Okay, I will try to answer. So I think, firstly, it is a very difficult, it's a very good question, but it's a very difficult one to quantify. How much do we know? You don't know what you know until you know what you don't know, right? But what I can say is that when it comes to research and development, South Africa is really leading the pack. We have excellent researchers. I'll give you a sense. Okay, I'm going to talk about SANSA because I'm really proud of SANSA. But in SANSA, one of our
chief skills that our researchers have is in physics. And our researchers currently publish at a rate of just over 3 publications per annum. And the annual average for South Africa is 1.5 across the country in all disciplines. So our researchers are really in the top. Our top 3 researchers in space science sit within the top 10% of the world in their field. And we know this through their H index and through their publication rates. And for me, that gives me confidence that we are leading, because our researchers are really able to hold their own and they're publishing at the
quality
rate
of quality that is world class. Thank you.
I think you would also know that we're building one of the largest radio telescopes not far from here. Same thing, we only know 4% of the matter in the universe. And that telescope, amongst other things, would be really probing more than the 4-5% that we know. So I think, again, South Africa's capability and investing in scientific capability to know more than what we don't know. And as you know, Minister, supported the establishment of, I think, about 10 or 15 researchers, sort of research chairs in the area of astronomy in the universities in South Africa as part of building beyond just in this area of space, but in the astronomy as well, because space is both looking up and looking down. Thanks.
Maybe then, if I can just add, having had the experts answering the more difficult part of the question. South Africa has got the single largest research infrastructure in the African continent. We have the single largest university system in the whole of the African continent. In fact, of every 10 foreign students who are studying in South Africa, 7 are from the rest of the African continent. Now, we are punching far above our weight also. The reason for saying that is that our spend on research and development as a percentage of GDP, we had 0.7 now, we're down. We've reversed from 0.8. We are aiming to reach 1.1% GDP spend on research and development by 2025, and 1.5% by 2030 in terms of the National Development Plan. China is what, 2.5? China is close to 3% GDP spent on research and development, science and innovation, just to give you a sense that we still have some way to go. You know, that is why, as I was saying earlier, that tomorrow we are having the second meeting of the Interministerial Committee on Science, Technology, and Innovation. Because what we are trying to do to try and increase spend is to better coordinate science, spending on science, technology, and innovation within government. That we want to align that better, we want to cooperate better, so that we minimize duplication, we minimize parallel programs, so that we make better use of the monies that is in the hands of government in terms of research and development. But also we are mobilizing, and we are worried that this decline from 0.8 about 2-3 years ago to 0.7, partly of course it's got to do with the negative impact on COVID, but where there has been a bigger decline is investment by the private sector in research and development. And that is what we are working towards mobilizing in quite a big way. One of the things we want to do is to also piggyback on the president's presidentially led investment drive, also for investment into our research and development and science. That is why the president's suggestion, DG, is an excellent one. Let's open these facilities to science tourism, because in that way we are able to showcase the rest of the world, the potential that we have, and in the process attract people who can actually invest in our system.
Thank you very much,
Minister. I hope that's helpful, all of that, yeah.
Can we have the mic here?
Good afternoon, Minister. This is Tamal Khan from Business Day. In your opening remarks earlier, you mentioned the business case that SANSA had put to your department for the new Space Capability Centre. Can you give us a sense of the commercial aspects of the venture in that business case? Was there a projection of the kind of revenue this institute is expected to generate? Yeah. And who are the customers? Are there customers already lined up? And then secondly, still on the subject of money, given the current squeeze on the fiscus, could you sketch how that's affected your department and funding for the entities that you oversee? And yeah, what kind of case will you be making to Treasury going into next year's budget to try and get a bigger slice of the pie for scientific research? Thanks.
Thanks very much. Very important questions. But can you allow me to start with Leanne,
and the DG, and then I'll come in with the easier part. Of ministers only answer easy questions, you know? Yes. Leanne?
Okay, I'll give it a try, Minister. yes, we put together a business case which included a cost recovery model and a revenue generation for the space with the center. The space with the center, the intention is that it will be run as a mixed income because there's a lot of public good and benefit to science and technology that will come from it, but there's also a lot of users who need the information and they need to be able to mitigate against the risk. So those users will become our clients and they will be right across the spectrum. So for example, the International Civil Aviation Organization, when they designated us, they said that they would work with the regional and the global centers to develop a cost recovery model so that we could reap revenue in order for us to be able to give them the customized service that they want for the aviation sector to have. And that's just one example. Our customers also include right across defense, aviation, maritime, the mining sector, the agricultural sector, anybody who uses the navigation aid, telemetry device, specialized electronics will require this kind of service. We did give the department a projection. I think we said that we needed to go from 3 to 10 years after the establishment in order to be able to build the customer base, but also because awareness is quite low in terms of space weather. And I like to tell my team that, you know, if you're sitting in a microwave oven, we all know we need a microwave oven, we all know we need a mobile phone. We don't all know that we need space weather information, so we need time to build it up. And that's what we've been doing. We've been creating awareness sessions and also trying to help users to understand what they can get out of the service. I think that was what the essence of the business case was. And if I may say, DG, I think we made a good case because here we are now.
thanks very much. Minister, we've agreed with the space agency that the principle is that in the initial 7 to 10 years, we will provide the larger portion of the budget for operationalization of the center. And that ratio would begin to shift once the customer and the client base has been built and the reputation has been built. But we will always, I think, from the department, provide funding. You heard in the briefing from forecasters that you need to be on an ongoing basis thinking about data analytics capabilities, which we invest in together with SANSA and the Center for High Performance Computing, the next generation of research and development for you to be able to be even accurate and more specially focus in the rest of the continent. Those would still come, I think, from ourselves as the department.
Yeah.
Thanks very much.
No, thank you. Maybe then to add, because it's a very important question, you know, set of questions that you are asking. We have already been asked by the president to make a case for more funding, initially from the fiscus, for our Department of Science and Innovation. We're in the process of doing that. As I was saying earlier, we are meeting tomorrow as the Interministerial Committee, partly also to look into that. What case do we need to be making to Cabinet, to Treasury, in order to be able to increase? Because we are absolutely clear as government, without more investment into research and development, even our own economic growth and development actually is under serious threat. These days in a modern economy, you can't grow and develop unless you invest in science, technology, and innovation. So that is very important. That is why the president has been doing this. I've already mentioned how we are trying to pull together what we call budget coordination at government level so that you don't have parallel programs, you know, wastage and so on. But in addition to all of that, we're also going to be establishing an innovation fund, which we are going to be mobilizing both from the fiscus as well as from the private sector. A fund that we'll be able to use in order also to prioritize areas for increased investment in terms of research and development. We've said, for instance, we have a decadal plan that is one very important platform. We want R&D monies on climate change, on alternative sources of energy, on the future of work, in agriculture, in health innovation. Key areas that are actually very important. So as well as, by the way, the one area that we are putting in a hell of a lot of work is the hydrogen economy as an alternative source of energy. We have got lots of advantages in South Africa such that we project. I've launched what is called Hydrogen Society Roadmap, that if we are really able to increase our investment and to grow the hydrogen economy, by 2030 we could actually be making billions of US dollars worth of turnover and investment into our own economy. So the point I'm making is that we don't want to go to Treasury and say, try and help us, or to the private sector, just to grow generally. We have priority areas that we have identified, which are in our decadal plan, and which also are very urgent things, like alternative sources of energy. It's an obvious area of growth, because also there is a need on that. Thank you. I hope that satisfies Business Day with your own stringent criteria, we know, for reporting on such matters.
All right. Thank you, Minister. We have three hands. This is the last
yes.
round that we are going to take. Thank you very much. You can.
Good morning. Actually, it's good afternoon now. My name is Kanya Jonas, and I represent XA Live. It's a youth show on Cape Town TV. Looking at the team that is actually taking part and that's actually monitoring the space weather patterns at the center, we can proudly say that it's a majority of female representation. In the current state that we're at, we're only like 13% of graduates in STEM fields are actually going out into the field. What kind of representation or advancement for women in STEM is the center actively trying to do? That's my question. Thank
okay.
you.
Right. Obviously, we start. Now, I don't have anything to write. Maybe let's allow that. You will memorize them with your younger mind.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So.
Do you have a question as well?
Yes.
All right. Please go ahead.
Hi, my name is Ande. I'm from Impact News. I'm based in Atlantis. So my question, you spoke about briefly about global warming and how you monitor the weather from space. So I'd like to know the implications on climate change, on how will this help? How will this institution help further with climate change and global warming?
Thank you. Okay. Thank you very much. These are the only two questions.
Okay.
Okay, cool. I'm Kezia from Cape Town TV. So my question is, with the amazing capabilities that the center is providing to our region, as well as with the collaboration in science, with the amazing thing called load shedding occurring right now, what role does it play in terms of the center being launched?
Okay. Thank you very much.
All right, we'll do the same. We start with Sansa, then DSI, then myself. Yes.
Okay, I have another
go. Yes, please, Leanne, please.
Okay, so on the
mic is off there. Something's not right. All right.
And now?
Yep.
Okay. Now I can hear myself as well. So the question on female representation, so definitely we have a very intentional drive to bring more female researchers into the sector. And you met the space weather team this morning, which was obviously where you saw the female representation. But we didn't have a chance to introduce you to our research team. And our research team in the last 10 years has gone from 2% women to 44% women in our research team. It's an intentional drive to make an environment conducive to women researchers. We also tried to make sure that what we have, I mean, this is an exciting field. And when I say it's exciting, of course, you think, yeah, right, she's in the field, so she's going to think it's exciting. But it is wow, and it's right there. It's the subject, it's being discussed at an international level. There's unanswered science questions. You want to do something new, you want to do something unique, you want to do something exciting, you want to be the first, then do this. And we've met lots of young women who want to be the first. Those group of forecasters, when we interviewed them, I say to the group, if you are going to be the first forecaster, Well, you're going to go be the first people to go on this training program. You're going to be the first people to run in an operational space with the center. If you don't want to be first, then this isn't the environment for you. And they all stayed in the room because they all wanted to be part of that. So that's creating that excitement. But it's an intentional drive we have to ensure that the environment is conducive to women scientists and researchers. We do also have men. So I don't want them to feel outdone, but it's an intentional drive for that.
Maybe, Minister, if I can actually add to that.
Yes.
So within SANSA itself.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
We'll behave from now. So that's within the SANSA, especially on the research side. But we also offer bursaries and thanks to the Department of the Additional Research Foundation. And in the past couple of years, we've been tracking the progress we're making in ensuring that we support more females into entering into the field. In 2016, we were supporting about 32% of the bursaries that we are awarding were female. This year, last year, 2021, 2022, we closed the year at 52% females in the bursary program. So as Leanne said, we're very intentional about the drive of including women within the program. We don't want to be the only ones. Might have been the first, but absolutely not the only ones. Minister, if you will allow me, I would like to take the question on climate change.
Yeah.
So we might not see it directly in terms of the space weather, in terms of how we can contribute to climate change, but as a space agency, with some of our programs, one is the Earth Observations program, and that's where we see the environmental monitoring and impact, whether it's declining waters or whether the impact on agriculture itself. And so if you look at flood predictions and drought predictions that the Department of Water and Sanitation has in the background and part of the information pack that's used, it's satellite products and services that we're actually providing to the department. With the recent floods that we've had, some of the analysis, especially when it comes to the impact, there is the forecasting element, but when we're talking about the impact of climate change, it's also the adaptation and the mitigation side. The response element becomes very critical, and that's also where space plays a big role. So we do provide information and supporting products and services to the local municipalities and the National Disaster Management Center as well in that regard.
Fiji?
No, I think we can talk about other investments on science for climate change, but I think...
Yeah, okay. I think that is inevitable. Partly that's why I was asking the question inside, is this also a research center rather than just being a space where the center? Because precisely that is what is on my mind, that the space where the patterns are also likely to reflect what is happening to Mother Earth and its the space, you know, in terms of climate change, the negative impact. This is very one important source of changes that will actually begin to tell us, you know, whether such changes are just happening naturally or are happening as a result of other impacts and so on. So it becomes part of the architecture of research infrastructure in terms of understanding climate change better. I have a proper understanding of it. Now, the DG is graduating me now as a Minister of Science, you see, not just higher education.
Okay, the last question.
What was the last question?
Load shedding.
Oh, load shedding. Oh, yeah. You know, psychologically, you tend to suppress that question unconsciously. Who will, yes.
Okay. So I was trying to suppress it, but my CEO was going to. Make sure you answer that question. So we're hoping that with our research and our investigation and what we do in the space with the center, we will actually enhance the technology that will allow us to protect the country from further blackouts and electricity blackouts. I would be amiss, though, if I didn't say that load shedding was one of the risks we had to mitigate in order to build a 24/7 centre, which we managed to do. But it also gives us an opportunity. It gives us an opportunity to assist the country in building a more secure and less vulnerable power grid system. Because space weather does have an impact on the power grid system. And by learning about it, understanding the impact and the technologies involved, we can have a better understanding of how to protect the grid. And I think that's what we're all going to need in the future. I hope that's okay.
Yes, yeah, no, that's fine. Viva science.
Exactly.
Pantsing and load shedding. All right.
All right. Ladies and gentlemen, this brings us to the end of our media briefing. Any further questions, you are free to engage with the center, with the department as well, will then respond. Thank you very much for your time. Lunch is served, please.
Yes, lunch is served.
Okay.
Where?
Okay.
In the marquee.
First stop we had in the marquee.
The rest of the guests will go to the tent.
Okay. You are welcome to go to the marquee, ladies and gentlemen, for lunch. Thank you very much. You can have your
yes. Oh, okay. So
it's a that photo.
Oh, yes, yes, yes.
HMS, you can come beside me. Oh, the weather service as well. Oh, okay. Yes.
General baggage.
We met a Cuba.
Yes.
Oh, is it?
Just to add, I know this business because of the idea of the first time. And thank you for taking care of me.
I like that one.
lost, you found a way to bring me back. Needed forgiveness, you always gave me that. Girl, I'm a witness of your looks, you don't be giving up. And it's crazy how you saved me. Hand on the Bible, don't know how I got you, but I couldn't ask for more. Girl, what we got's worth thanking God for. So thank God I get to wake up by your side. And thank God your hand fits perfectly in mine. Thank God you love me when you didn't have to, but you did, and you do, and he knew. Thank God for giving.